friends. Welcome to the LA Zoo Presents Animal Draw-Alongs with Brian Kesinger. I'm your host, Sienna Spencer-Markles from the LA Zoo. And for those of you joining us for the first time, I'd like to introduce our very talented friend and artist, Brian Kesinger, who has worked with Disney, Marvel, and Lucasfilm, and you may also know him through his successful Otto and Victoria franchise, as well as many other cool characters and worlds that he's created over the years. This is week three of our draw-along series as we bring the zoo to you. In this series, we're taking a closer look at four endangered species that the LA Zoo is actively helping to save from extinction. Today, we'll be drawing the Peninsular Pronghorn, otherwise known as the Berendo, which is a beautiful hoofed animal that is kind of a cross between an antelope and a goat. Pronghorn are a critically endangered species native to the deserts of Baja California, Mexico. They are the world's fastest living hoofed mammals and the world's second fastest land mammal, the fastest in North America. They're able to run speeds up to 60 miles per hour for sustained periods, unlike the cheetah, who is only able to maintain that speed in short bursts. In fact, they are nicknamed ghosts of the desert because of their camouflage coloration and their ability to escape at high speed, making them all but disappear. Once numbering in the thousands, today approximately 150 pronghorn are left in the wild due to cattle ranching, livestock fencing, human development, and drought. Since the year 2000, the Los Angeles Zoo has participated in the Peninsular Pronghorn Recovery Project. In addition, the LA Zoo's breeding herd is part of a species survival plan for peninsular pronghorns, and this means that we actively maintain a healthy population in human care in case numbers in the wild continue to decline. The Pronghorn Recovery Program also releases captive-bred pronghorn into protective wild areas. By helping bolster the wild population, we hope to change their critically endangered status. We have more than a dozen peninsular pronghorn at the LA Zoo, and if you get a chance to see them up close in person, they have the most beautiful eyes with these long, dreamy eyelashes. Pronghorn can see for miles, and their field of vision spans an amazing 300 degrees. In fact, they have the largest eyes of any North American hoofed animal their size. I just love them. Get it? Anyway, here we go. Get your paper, your pens, and your pencils ready. Take it away, Brian.
Thank you so much, Sienna. Man, this is a pretty amazing animal. Truth be told, I didn't know much about them until I started researching them for this video. And like you said, there's so much, so many interesting facts, so many interesting aspects to this animal. So I'm very excited to teach you all how to draw him. You see, I have my usual supplies here that I like to use. I can't believe we're on week three already. This is great. So I got my eraser, I got my blue pencil, and a pen. But you can do this all with pencil, all with pen, even crayons work, right? Because I'm just going to be teaching you today the ideas behind drawing this beautiful animal. And then it's up to you as the artist to take those tools and make it your own. The first thing I want to do, though, because it has been a week since we were last drawing together, let's get a piece of paper out and just start doing some circles, right? We're going to do a little warm-up exercises. I forgot to do this last week, and I kind of felt it. This is just like how you would stretch before doing a workout, right? Let me get my lighting a little better here. So less shadows. And what this is going to do is just loosen up your hand, loosen up your arm, and just kind of in these round shapes. Notice I'm not doing a circle slowly like this. We really want to loosen up and just do big circles like that, right? So you got some little bubbles going on your page. Once you feel comfortable and all that, go ahead and bring out a clean sheet of paper or another area on that piece of paper you used before. And we're going to start drawing this great peninsular pronghorn. But you know me, I always like to do my research first. That's one of the things I love about the LA Zoo is it's a great place and a great resource. Even though we're all sheltering at home right now, you can even go to their website and they have got great facts, great observations about the animals that you can study and learn about them, even if you can't visit right now. But we're going to go and look at this great photo here. And I believe it's on the screen, so you can see it as well. But what I want to show you, of course, is the skull of this animal, which is pretty cool, right? And remember my friend Sienna talked about the biggest eyes, right? Look at those eye sockets, right? They're pretty huge compared to the rest of the skull. So that's very interesting to note. While we're all looking at this together, we can start identifying big shapes. And right now I'm seeing a triangle, right? I'm seeing like 3 points, 1, 2, and 3. Probably going to start with a triangle. And then you got the great V shape, right, of the horns there. And they are horns. They're not antlers, right? There is a difference. And antlers typically fall off and regrow on animals. And horns are permanent. And these horns have a bony center, but this dark color is all keratin, which is like the material of your fingernails. So kind of interesting how we are very different animals, but connected in some way, right? Kind of cool. All right. So let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to position my camera back so we can look at the page. And we're just going to start out with lines, nice and easy, right? This is all a way to structure your drawing so that it's not as intimidating. Because obviously, you look at the animal and you're like, oh, where do I begin? Well, let's begin with one line. Let's put one line on our page. And we're going to do this right here. And it's going to kind of go at an angle, right? Our one line there. Just like that. Great. Now, we're going to do another line. We're going to make like a T section here. And what I want you to do so that you know where to place this next line, I want you to go ahead and cut this big line in half. Right? So just a little line right there so that you know a bottom half and a top half. That there. Now go ahead and divide the top half into a half again. Right? Like so. And that's actually where we're going to place our second big line. And it's going to be kind of at a 90 degree angle of your initial line. So it'll look like a T or a cross kind of at an angle, right? So that's good. Pretty easy so far. Now we're going to go ahead and connect this point, these two points to here, right? So we're going to get a line there and a line there. So you're getting two similar but slightly different shaped triangles back to back, like so. Great. Now, I want you to connect this line to your halfway mark of your initial first line, right? It's almost like we're playing connect the dots right now, which we kind of are. Now, from that center line that you just connected to this point here, go ahead and connect those two lines. And you should have now, your T should now look like a bit of a kite, right? Looks like you have your kite here and your long tail coming down here. this doesn't look at all like a peninsular pronghorn, but don't worry, it will. This is all the architecture that we're putting in to help add some structure and a little bit of a roadmap to our drawing. Okay. Great. You guys are doing awesome. Now at the bottom here, the bottom of your first line, go ahead and draw a little line. If this was a clock, it would be at 5 o'clock, right? So draw a little line coming back like so. Great. Awesome. You guys are doing so good. Okay, ready? This is going to be a fun line to draw. From the bottom of that line to, let's say, to here. Yeah, to the right-hand corner of your kite. Go ahead and draw a line. And it can be a straight line, but we're going to curve it later. But for now, go ahead and draw a line between those two points. Got it? Awesome. Cool. So now what I'd like you to do, let's go back to our center line, our main line, right? And this is an important thing for drawing. You always want to look at something and figure out what's the biggest line, the most continuous line, because that becomes your home base. That becomes the anchor that you can always fall back to. So we're going to go back to our home base here with this line, and we're going to add another line exactly parallel with it and have it go a little bit past the halfway point. Right? And go ahead on the other side, do the same thing, same distance. Parallel line just going beyond, a little bit beyond the halfway point. If you are just using a pen or one pencil, go ahead and do all this a little lighter because we're going to go in later and darken the lines we want to keep. But for now, we're just laying in these structural details. Okay, great. So we have two parallel lines. Now what I want you to do is go ahead and do two parallel lines equidistant from each other around that line, that 5 o'clock line that we drew. We're working on the dimension of the muzzle right now. If you can kind of see, we're starting to transition from two-dimensional lines to three-dimensional form. And I'm being sneaky about it so that it's not too intimidating. But you're actually drawing some pretty sophisticated stuff right now. So you should be very proud of yourself. Great. Awesome. Now, let's get in to a little bit more of the details. First things first, and something that's very important to these animals, right, are the eyes. So we have this line here, right? And this section here, this point, starting here, and don't draw yet. Just watch what I'm going to do. We're going to draw a circle at about that halfway point of this line and have it end at that point. So we have a little circle there. Great. Now, on the other side, do you remember if you were with us last week and we drew the frog, we were able to make objects look like they were on the other side of an animal's head by showing less of the same shape, right? And we're going to do the same thing here because, as you can see, and I believe you have the photo up on your screen, look at the photo on the left, which is the same one I'm drawing from. These animals, like most prey animals, have eyes on the sides of their heads, right? Sienna mentioned that they have a 300-degree eyeline eyesight. That's because their eyes are on the side of their heads, not on the front of their heads, like ours are, like humans are, or like predator animals typically have eyes on the front of their faces. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this same circle and we're going to have it end in the same spot. So it's going to take about halfway there. But we're going to see less of it when the details come in. This is a funky looking creature right now, isn't it, on your page? Don't worry. It'll all come together. It's going to come together quick, too, once we get all these anchor points in. Now, what I would love from this point, the top of your kite to the right corner of your kite, go ahead and draw a curved, almost like a half circle, connecting those two. Like so. Got it? And then we're going to have another triangle coming off the back end here of this. And I want you to, from the center of your kite, draw a line cutting that half circle in half. Okay? So get a line like here. And then what you're going to do from that line is draw a bit of a straight line there. And then another straight line going up like that. So if this was a clock, you're going to draw about 9:10. Right on the clock. And then go ahead and from this point all the way back to the middle of the eye, draw a curve. This is the ear of the animal. Great. Now, back at the top of the kite, we're going to have a triangle shape. I'm sorry, actually, we're going to have a straight line going up. And then another rounded shape coming to halfway of the left-hand side of the kite, top left. Great. Now, it wouldn't be a peninsular pronghorn without its pronged horns. So we're going to map that in next so that we kind of know where those are going to go. And something interesting about the pronghorn is that, and Sienna, I can't remember if you mentioned this or not, that they're the only animal that has pronged horns, right?
Yeah, they're the only animals with branched horns.
Branched horns. That's right. That's right. So
another fun fact.
Yeah, kind of cool. So we're going to start placing those in now. And the first one, what we're going to do is going back to this part of the eye, right? We're going to draw a line that goes straight. It follows parallel to your main anchor line, right? Go ahead and just draw a line like that there. And then here, halfway on this line here, we're going to draw another one going up parallel to your anchor line, right? It's very interesting, and I talked about this a little bit last time too, but just the geometry and the architecture of how animals are put together is pretty amazing when you think about it, because what we're going to do now is where this line intersects the kite line. We're going to draw out a straight line this way. And if this was a clock, we're drawing at 11 o'clock position, just to help you with your angles.
Can you, speaking of angles, Brian, can you show the audience the angle of your photo that you're drawing from on your pad there?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay, great.
Yeah, so I'm drawing that right there. And the line we just put in for the antler is going to be that line. And now we're going to put the next one in, right, which is going to be not exactly parallel to that one. It's going to be more at an angle like this, like so. Now at the top, go ahead and have this curve up, like so. And same with the other one, have that curve up, like so. And then from the bottom, from where you initially drew your horn starting, draw another line that kind of curves out this way. And then from the bottom, draw a third line that kind of arcs and goes about halfway up. Right? We're working on the different prongs of the pronghorn. And now on this horn here, we're going to have one curve kind of come up. And then another line coming up here. Right? Not too bad. You guys are through the toughest part right now. We're going to add a couple more anchor points, and then we'll start really filling in the details. The big one I want to do right now is the neck of the animal. And so at our kite line, right, if you can still find it, go ahead and follow that half circle you drew, but pull it down into a straight line there. And then from the bottom of the kite on your anchor line, lightly sketch in another line parallel to that line. Like so. Great. Amazing. So now we're going to work on the muzzle and the cute little mouth on this animal. So what we're going to do is back here, we're going to add a little bit of a V shape. You're going to start it a little ways down there. Little V shape, kind of a rounded V. And then go ahead and give it a rounded curve to connect the two points of that V. Great. Now, go ahead, the line that's here, divide that in half And from the top line here to that newly made halfway point, do like a half circle.
We just switched up the photo to match yours, Brian.
Oh, okay, great. Thank you. And now on the other side from that halfway point, go ahead and draw a longer curved line that kind of goes down at the end. Looks like a little pleasant smile. He's saying, thanks for drawing me today. I'm endangered. Please help. and now, go ahead at the bottom, and we're going to round out the bottom of this lower lip, this lower jaw, and have it come almost to the smile, to the end of the mouth there. Great. Really good. Now, where you stopped your line, go ahead and do like a backwards C, kind of an elongated backwards C. And you'll get the little impression, and you'll see it in the photo there. The little impression of the fold of the skin of the mouth kind of bunching up while it's in its closed position. I read another fun fact that I think is pretty adorable, that because these animals are so fast and they run so fast, they have a lot of enlarged organs. Mm-hmm. Like, so their lungs and their hearts, right, are bigger than the normal animals their size. And when they run with their mouth open so that they get more air in, right, which is pretty clever. But because of that, their tongues hang out when they run. So that'd be a pretty funny sight and a funny drawing to see one of these peninsular pronghorns running with its tongue out like a dog. So pretty endearing. Great. So now we're going to go from the midway point of that C that you drew. Go ahead and draw a nice kind of round curve that's going to connect to the eye. That where the kite meets the end of the eye there, that point there.
Now I feel like our pronghorns are starting to take shape.
Yes.
Does everyone's pronghorn at home look like an animal instead of geometric shapes and lines?
It's so true. I often refer to the underdrawing phase as kind of like the part where I have to eat my vegetables before I can have dessert, right? Like the dessert is drawing all the fun details and especially these eyelashes, right? So spectacular. But we want to make sure we have a solid underdrawing. So you're all doing really good at being patient and following along. Because, yeah, I agree. Now with the muzzle and the nose, it's starting to actually look like one of these little guys. And to help that, we're going to actually start working on the eyes now. So we drew a pretty open circle. But what I want you to do is from these two midpoints, go ahead first and draw a kind of shallower circle, right? You have your big circle here, but we're actually going to draw a smaller circle right there. That's going to be the upper eyelid. We're going to do the same thing down here. We're going to draw a little shallower curve, and we're actually going to give it a thicker line at the bottom. If you look at the picture on your left, you'll see that it's got like where the fur has gone away, there's like a black eyelid, almost like a very gothy eyeliner, right? It's a goth pronghorn. So we got our thick bottom line there. Great. And then what we're going to do is draw these eyelashes, right? Pretty spectacular. And how we're going to do that is we're going to draw kind of a line that goes out underneath your eyelid that you just drew. And it's going to be kind of a smooth curve there. And go ahead and connect it to the point there.
These eyelashes are so beautiful in person. I've seen them at our zoo, and when they bat their eyes, I feel like the eyelashes create a wind effect.
Wow. That's so cool.
Maybe they're born with it.
Maybe it's pronghorn. So now that you have those lines, just go ahead and connect them and draw in these little lines following those curves, and you'll get the nice little eyelash there, which is a very good compliment to the smile. very, very pleasing looking animal. And then what you can do just simply is lightly color in the eye there, leaving a little circle open for the reflection, right? Like so. Now on to the other eye, right? And we're going to kind of create that illusion of depth, even though this is a two-dimensional drawing. So we have our circle for the other eye, right? I would love for you to cut that in half and draw, even more than half, two-thirds, draw a curve like that, kind of bisecting the eye there. It's going to be a little tricky, but you guys can do it. And then from that line here, where your new line connects to the kite, go ahead and draw a curve coming down to just below half of your initial anchor line, right? You can see why all these lines come in handy. Now we're going to do the eyelids on this eye, right? And so we're going to do a line here that kind of cuts at 11 o'clock on that eye. And then at 8 o'clock, do another line. So you have a little sideways V coming off of that. And then color in what's left, that little area in between that little triangle. You can see I'm a little more well-fed this week. There's not as many food references. Otherwise, I would have called that fill in the little pizza slice there. and then go ahead, and this is fun, draw the eyelashes coming off of the eye there. Like so. Great. And I know we're running a little longer today, but we're almost done because we're going to fill out the shape of the horns itself. And then we'll start just picking our favorite lines and finishing up the drawing. So we've got about maybe 5 or 7 minutes left. So hang in there. You're doing really good. From this line, from the top of that curve, go ahead and draw a line that kind of connects to that curve. Now from this line, the tip of there, go ahead and draw a line like that, that then starts to run parallel of the main horn line. And then it looks like in the picture it has one more little prong I'm going to do a little check there. Like that. Before connecting it back to the horn there. Like so. Back at this line here, this point, go ahead and draw it down a little bit, connecting back to your initial line for your placement of the horn. We're going to do the same thing here from this point that we drew. Have it arc down and connect to the base there. Like so. And then go ahead and connect this line up into a parallel line. Drawing that same little bump out that we had on that antler, or that horn, excuse me. How dare I? And then connect it back into that point. And go ahead and drag parallel line back down to the skull. Don't worry, I didn't forget about that one prong. And we're going to have from that prong there, that point, just draw another line down and have it merge into that bigger line you just drew. Great. Now, it looks like in the photo that there's these little, like, the tufts of hair growing at the base of the antlers, if you look at the photo. So we're going to imply that there just by adding a little bit of a curve, a little bit of curve on there. Great. So now we're done with all our structure, and you guys deserve a medal because these type of animals are some of the hardest to draw because they're the most alien looking, right? They have so many different points.
Yeah, I feel like this is the most challenging of the three that we've done so far.
Yeah, no, it really is. It's not just you. And it's why we're at week three with this one, because there's a few more steps. But again, a lot of this comes from studying and being able to recognize different skull shapes and how they're put together. That lets you simplify it, right? So hopefully now you've had a little bit of grasp of how, you know, just by starting with a T, that kind of long line that goes against the line that the eyes sit on, you can really anchor everything around that. So I'm going to start inking this and pulling out my favorite lines, and you guys can too. If there's any comments or questions, now would be a good time to pick them up, or we could go through them.
Great. Thank you, Brian. I'd love to just describe the coloring of the animal. If anyone after the draw along wants to paint or color their pronghorn, as you can see in the photo, the pronghorn is a golden brown or a tan. They have white on their lower neck, their jaws, their stomach, their rump. They have white underbellies, which deflect heat from the ground. The males are larger with darker faces and longer horns. So keep that in mind as you color in your pronghorn. Does anyone have any questions for Brian as far as what pens he's using, you know, how he'll what the lines are that he's choosing to emphasize? Brian, does drawing a pronghorn remind you of any animals that you've drawn for Disney or Marvel, or is there a similar creature that you've created?
That's a great question. No, not me personally, but I know, like just speaking to the complexity of the animal, I know that way back when the studio was working on Bambi, right, which was in the 40s, they had to do a lot of drawing from nature. Walt Disney had realized that up until that point, they had done very cartoony animals, right? Even in Snow White, which was their first fully animated feature. If you look at Snow White today, the animals in that movie still look very cartoony, like the little deer that's licking the dishes to help clean and that sort of thing, look very old-fashioned. But he knew when they started Bambi that it was going to be an all-animal cast, so it needed to have a different level of sophistication. So they would actually bring deer into the drawing studio so that the artist could learn and draw from life, because that is so important. And we still do that to this day. I guess now that I'm thinking about it out loud, the character that this reminds me of that I did work on was Gazelle from Zootopia, right? When we worked on Zootopia, we continued that tradition of drawing from life, and we had animals brought into the studio, and we got to draw them. And one of my favorites was the fennec fox, because we had a fennec who was one of our main characters. But for Gazelle, who was voiced by Shakira, it was a combination of studying how gazelles are designed and put together, and also studying how Shakira does her music videos and dance moves. So it was kind of a dream job.
That's great. Does everyone want to give a shout out of where they're watching from? I see we have someone from the Berlin Zoo.
Oh, wow.
Joining us today. We have a watcher from Finland.
Amazing.
Lots of locals, Los Angeles, Southern California, of course.
Yay.
Thousand Oaks, Altadena, Burbank, Pasadena.
Amazing. Thank you all so much for watching. Yeah, it's very fun. I love seeing, I've been getting tagged in some photos on social media and seeing just the range. In fact, this morning I saw someone post from Paris. Posted their drawing of our frog that we did last week.
Awesome. We have
cool.
Las Vegas, the UK, Long awesome. Island.
Wow. Thank you all so much. So yeah, I'm going in and I'm just picking out the main lines that stick out to me from my drawing versus the photo, right? So you can see I'm following, you know, those parallel lines we did before, but I'm not connecting it to the fur up here, just to leave that little feeling of where the fur is longer. Now I'm going to show you how I'm going to outline these horns, because that's going to be interesting. Because look at the photo, look at that interesting texture. It almost looks like burnt wood, right? So when you outline these horns, go ahead and give it more of a wobbly line, right? And that'll kind of indicate that texture, even though it's a flat drawing. And you can go ahead too on the interior and add some of those bumps. Just really randomly, right? This is where you really get to express yourself as an artist. Draw more of the fur there. Then we get more wrinkly line for the other horn. Like so. We'll follow it up here. Yeah, this was a tricky one this week, for sure.
I thought the condor was going to be harder than it was. It turned out to be pretty easy for people to draw, and their drawings they sent in were excellent. The frog was great. But yeah, this one is a little more challenging. I imagine next week's, which will be our gorilla baby, will be pretty familiar to people since it's a primate, you know, similar to us humans.
Yes, that's exactly right. I anticipate the drawing next week will be will be simpler in that regard because it's a little more familiar. So, but please do share what you've drawn this week, especially if you add some color or if you add one thing I didn't get to cover here, but which is very important to the animal, are its markings, right? And the big area on the snout there, right? The muzzle, having that big blacker fur and the white fur goes a long way to indicating what species of animal this is. So definitely a little bit of homework for you guys is before you post, take some time and try to use these same skills of observation and see where those markings can go. Because look, even under its jaw, back up towards the side of the head where the eye is, there's a little patch of black fur, right? Before it goes into those cool white stripes leading to the white underbelly. So definitely take some time and finish off your drawing by adding those markings in. And I think you'll be impressed with how much it really helps in creating the likeness of the animal.
Brian, how would you recommend folks finish their drawings? Could they use crayons or paints or pens? What would you do to color the pommel?
All of the above, or colored pencils as well are really good. But even if you use the same pencil, there's ways to shade and indicate. Like, for instance, now that I'm pretty much done with the inking, I would go in and lightly with my pencil sketch in the line where the white markings would go, right? And you don't have to follow along for this if you don't want. You can just watch. But I'd lightly mark in those lines. There's one here for the ear, right? And then what I would do is I go in and lightly color in the fur. And this is just using the same pencil. By applying different amounts of pressure, you can get different shades and different values. So I'm going in right now and I'm adding in this fur texture here. And then what I'm going to do, which is off here, and then the ears as well. So, and of course, the great little V shapes on the neck, like that. But then, once that light value is in there, is in place, then I can go in a little darker with the same pencil and indicate where the darker fur goes. And how it goes up into the forehead. There. And you can see, now look, isn't this interesting? How much more this now looks like the animal now that these kind of big markings are in place. Does that make sense? That. Let me get a little bit more of the darker there. And then, of course, these horns being dark. There. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to break up my coloring in here into little chunks, like so. And that again helps reinforce the texture of the horn, right? Now it's got, it looks like it has little highlights like it does in the picture, because the horn's going to be a little shinier than the fur is. So you want to kind of represent that in your drawing to kind of get all of that in there.
It sounds like drawing animals is all about observation.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's not something that you can make up. You can make up creatures and designs, of course, for fun and that sort of thing. But you'll be amazed at how much your drawing improves by going out and actually observing the animal. You can see, too, that I'm coloring it in a fashion so that it feels like fur, right? That I'm not, like, solidly coloring it in, but by giving it shorter, bristly strokes in the direction that the shapes are going, you feel like the fur is wrapping around the muscle, which is wrapping around the skull, right? And one thing for extra credit, if you want to do, just because it's so interesting, and again, so alien, the pupils of this animal are actually rectangle, right? They're not circle. And that, again, allows the animal to see much more of their horizon and keep an eye out for predators.
That's right. Another amazing fact about this species. There are so many.
I know.
They also can go for weeks without drinking.
Really? I know I can't. Especially in quarantine.
Especially on the weekend.
Right.
And my favorite fact is at 4 days old, pronghorn fawns can outrun humans when they're four days old.
At 4 days old. I'm guessing at 1 day old, it can outrun me. So, but I think we're wrapping up here. I think this is starting to take shape. And again, just want to say thank you, Sienna. Thank you, LA Zoo, for having me be a part of this.
Thank you so much, Brian. That's really fun. And as Brian mentioned, please feel free to post your art from today's drawing. You can post it anywhere you like and tag at LA Zoo and at Brian Kesinger. And feel free to color it in, finish it off however you like, add your splotches and have fun with it. This is, I just wanted to mention that we, if you see, we have pronghorns behind me here in one of our new virtual.
Look out.
Look out. They're very gentle. I just want to stare into their big dreamy eyes.
So
we have a bunch of wonderful virtual backgrounds filled with animals available on our site that you can download at lazoo.org, the Wild for the Planet page. We have all your favorite animals and we're adding new every week. So download some virtual Zoom backgrounds and be the talk of the town at your next meeting. So this was the third in our series of four Saturday drawalongs with Brian Kesinger. So please join us next Saturday, the final Saturday, May 9th, as we draw our Western Lowland Gorilla Baby, Angela. Same time, same channel. And for more zoo content, please visit lazoo.org. And on behalf of Brian Kesinger and all of us at the LA Zoo, thank you so much for joining us today, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye.
Bye.
Thank you.